he's playing with him, but it's because of his outspoken nature.
Of course.
He puts himself on that kind of thing. The rest of his team doesn't have to cop any flack. Yeah. And he's got that sort of mentality. He has that winner's mentality. I don't care what you say, I'm going to succeed.
Yeah.
It took him such a long time. Who transitions after what? It was like 2 years of a coach role, steps in at the last second after...
6 years between his last TI performance, like appearance, and winning it.
I mean, he
paneled and casted at some, that's not true. Yeah.
You know, the funny thing is it hasn't changed.
Just kidding, I'm just kidding.
It hasn't changed a bit after TI. I was reading Reddit last night after the game. Yeah. The number of flames after game one against NiP, and then he comes back and he plays the best Core Profit game since TI in game two, and there's not a single comment. He's like that guy, that player that goes to road games and just goes to the crowd. Turn
to bad. Yeah, I mean, what was it, a week, 10 days after he won TI, he was playing a pub, and he was having an argument with a guy in a game about how to play the game. And it was on Reddit.
Yep. Of course.
Because he was arguing with a guy, and the guy was like, you know, who do you think you are, a TI winner?
This is interesting. OG has looked at those games from this morning. That was the first two DJ Phoenix games in this patch. It was actually the first two Ice Chaos Knight games in the last two patches, and they take it away in the first one.
I really liked how they played with this CK. I know it's been on the rise, of course, for that like off lane, and then he got nerfed, but I thought it played so perfectly into the way he wants to play. He's just very aggressive in your face, and he's just obnoxious, and that is exactly the style that I feel like that hero fits. Same thing with the Bruin. Fnatic changed the entire formula.
I asked, didn't I? I said, will they stick to banning three supports? And the answer is no.
They take out the Troll and the Ember and the Monkey King.
This is like the what Na'Vi did to Alliance, right? Where they just banned out, was it EGM instead of trying to ban out Bulldog?
Yep.
They just focused one hero. Yeah. They're like, guys, we can't. The thing about banning is, you can't just ban everything. You have to let something through in Dota. Teams play everything good.
IOTW's troll has been very good.
Yep. Yes.
Very
yes.
good at this tournament and before as well. For the Jerex the price. Monkey King.
Right?
I guess it's like, a Topson Monkey King ban. It's kind of banning two, isn't it?
Fnatic doesn't play which two heroes? Chen and Coddle.
Yeah.
They take the NP.
That's the problem, right? That's the problem. And I think you have to then pivot, think about pivoting back to the Tiny. I mean, I guess you can first phase Phoenix again, but CK that CK Phoenix. Counter is,
out.
Is,
CK's
is
out.
No longer there.
Yep. CK's gone. Remaining. Banned. Along with a brew.
And there's Shadow Shaman that they loved throughout the group stages. The ET Shadow Shaman that they did a lot is there.
Okay,
ET Lifestealer. I like that better.
Would you consider, what was it, NIP's counter was the Ursa? People have been doing Razor a lot, but I feel like Razor...
I think Ursa's
so OG
better.
Has not played Ursa since TI. That was one of the big heroes that I was looking at. They have OG has been leaving the Lifestealer in the pool, but they do not play Ursa.
The reason, by the way, I was saying that I like the Lifestealer better than the Shadow Shaman, I just think that Lifestealer is a crazy, ridiculous hero. Just like Will was saying, he's just a hero that can...
He does everything.
And it's one of those things where you look at OG, we talked about the duration splits for them and the fact that they haven't always reacted well when they're taking a life game. Lifestealer in this patch profiles as an extreme late game hero. His win rate is about 50-50 before 40 minutes, spikes up to close to 70% after that.
That rage talent.
Yeah.
Pretty ridiculous.
No, we saw the other night, right? With the rage talent and a BKB, and he's like, and a refresher, he has like 50 seconds of magic immunity.
Yeah, 52 seconds of magic immunity with a refresher shard. 5 seconds remaining. Or maybe I'm off. 51, sorry. BKB ticks down. If it's 10 seconds. Yeah, it's pretty crazy. Turn to ban. Hello.
Well done.
That's good.
So PA, so you got to ban Magnus, right?
I think. This is where, I mean, NIP didn't ban it second phase. Yesterday, and we were so surprised, but you got to believe that Magnus has to be in the forefront.
I'd consider getting rid of Batrider right now if I was OG.
If you're OG.
If you're OG, yeah.
I mean, if you're Fnatic, you don't care about Batrider. Lifestealer versus Batrider is probably like the best possible matchup you can get. But if you're OG, it's a vehicle for the Lifestealer, and more importantly, I think it's very good against both the Nature's Prophet and the PA. It's one of the few heroes that can pressure the PA because you don't rely on right-click side. But OG instead get rid of the Timbersaw.
Yeah, that was something that they were doing yesterday, both to protect against the Core Prophet, to preserve the flex value of that Prophet, and because so many of the heroes that Topson relies on the mid lane, that like that Monkey King, struggle with the Timberman.
Yeah, I think I absolutely love the Bat. I think I saw Liquid doing that today, actually, in MDL versus EG. Remaining. I think they did the Bat Rider versus the PA, and he just destroyed this PA the whole game.
I personally think, like, remember the game that I wanted a Bat Rider that we were watching together, too? I think this hero, he's not good in all situations, but in very specific ones where you can at least counter one core hero and you can at least deal with one of the supports, Like, if this is a double core, you feel pretty good about playing Batrider, I think, against both of them.
And you have a Lifestealer, so it's just like, it's a triple benefit.
Right. Really. Because I personally think, like, Lifestealer, you always want some kind of vehicle. The hero increases in value so much more when you just get the instant ability to just jump somebody. It's like your own version of, like, a mini Echo Slam, where you burst somebody down off the bat, you don't really have to use your rage or anything like that either, because, you know, they're held in place. Absolutely.
Yeah. And or just anyone to start the fight. That's always mine. Yeah. It's like, a vehicle is amazing. It's just, that's probably number one. Number two is still someone else. So someone to start the fight so you can just run in. And
the movement speed change to Firefly means they're no longer nearly blink dependent. You can infest with Nakes and you can start running those plays before the Blink Dagger comes up. Batrider, you have flexibility to build drums first. It just makes it feel so much more impactful.
Band Oracle, that's probably the Batrider.
Yeah, yep.
I would have imagined so, but who knows how...
I thought they would have snapped it if they...
Yeah, I thought after the first two picks...
Fnatic does not play Batrider. Or at least not in the last two patches.
Well, if they did, that would have been,
been good.
Again, it's tricky, right? Because when you analyze a team like Secret, they kind of play everything. Whereas when you're talking about these teams, there's a lot more sort of team-specific hero pools to play.
Fnatic also get last pick, right? You could do something like Storm, too, previous to what they did before. Storm doesn't feel bad against either of these heroes.
They're going to go back to the deep. Never mind. They run this Earth Spirit at both support positions.
I also don't know where the ET is still. I don't know if it could... And I think that could still be your 3 position hero.
I
saw a couple of teams run it, and it seems... decent.
I just don't think you... I don't think you can run... remaining. I think you've got so many effective ways now. You get so much catch to chase that NP into the trees.
You know what I really like, by the way, about Lifestealer as a pick? Just kind of ranting here. Is that when it comes to draft order, anyway, it's so nice to be able to just first to a core. It always is. And when you know your core is like, it's not really going to get countered by anything, it feels so good because you just don't... You can pick your supports later on. You can maintain that flexibility, or at least like the illusion of it. Like, this is still maybe this. Like, we can get questions asked about stuff like that. And it comes down to the fact that you can first to your carry or your mid like that. It feels really nice. Yeah.
I always loved whenever like the Jug and the Lifestealer are meta, because your carry player, he has a built-in BKB, so he can't be like, I need BKB to fight.
We don't have to play around that timing anymore. Yeah. And the other thing is that a lot of the heroes that counter the Lifestealer, you take something like an Ursa. They're heroes that, as long as the counter shows up early...
Is that the first Venge? That's the first Venge of the tournament, right?
It's the first Venge of this tournament. We saw it at... Newbie ran it at MDL.
Uh-huh.
But I believe it's the first... And this... Man, oh man.
An instant Darkseer. So that explains the Oracle. That explains the Oracle ban then, yeah. And snapped pick Nyx.
I think it kind of makes sense. I think it acts in a similar way as the bat. It just, you don't have as good of a jump, but at the same time, like, it's good overall team fight.
Where is this Venge going to play? 5 seconds remaining.
I'd imagine.
Is this core Venge?
I'm pretty sure she's his. I guess we'll see.
Sound I don't know. I actually band, think by I, the way.
100th right now?
Sound 100th. Oh, nice. Yeah.
Okay. That's band. A good round number, Paul. I'd like to keep it at that.
Yeah, Paul.
There's an Omni Knight.
Omni Knight?
Oh, no. It has had one ban, though. So it
yeah,
be
one
in
ban.
List. Yeah.
Do we count that? Dude, wait, really?
100 pixel ban.
We cannot count it. They can count it.
Yeah. I don't like that.
100 pixel ban.
What's the actual pick number?
Jacket, but
I like that Nyx's top guess. I like that Nyx pick. It sort of dissuades the Storm.
That was when we were talking about the Batrider earlier. That was one of
them. Yeah. Okay. I still like Storm against. I think he's one of the few in heroes I don't mind that much.
95
against Nyx.
Because your in game's not really that ridiculous.
No, it's not. And if you go Bloodstone, it doesn't make you take any additional damage. And importantly, unless you really mess up and you drop Remnant and he bets into the middle of it, you usually can't keep up with.
So, what do Fnatic go back for here? Ordinarily, Fnatic are a team that they like to pick these scaling heroes. They like to go later. I would not rule out something like an Abed Medusa, but this OG lineup has just such huge tempo potential.
I feel like your lineup is kind of like counterintuitive. You might be a little bit too...
I was thinking Dragonite.
Yeah, for Fnatic?
Yeah, just to round it in. It's just like this old Darkseer Dragonite thing that you group up in.
So is this going to be... Is this like Seb?
They've played one game of Venge since TI that IRTW played.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, I've only seen them play it as a core as well.
That's the only game they've played since TI Venge.
We also just you want to get the levels of swap online early so that you have the reach to get the lifesteal out of position.
The thing is that they have a PA, right? So it's just like, where do the I don't know. Like,
that was, by the way, it was at Bucharest Money.
You
want to
do like Quaswex Invoker or something? Keep people off? Debuff Surge?
For Urspur and Lifestealer, though.
Yeah, you kind of just get run at.
You just get eaten by those two. They just kill you by themselves.
Yeah.
I mean, nobody's really fun to play against, though, this problem.
It's very true.
You never, as a mid player, I'd be like, oh man, I die here quite a few times.
So do you go back to a Topson special and just pick a monkey? It's banned.
Already banned.
Oh no, Pugna. Wait, is Ember still? No, Ember's banned. And they banned all the cores, sure.
Oh, they did too. That's interesting.
Is that. Wait, Nyx? Who's mid?
Venge.
They don't have a true mid.
They don't have a true mid. It's going to be it's gonna be Venge or mid.
They have a lot of PA.
I think this might be. I think it's either PA or NP.
Huh.
10 seconds remaining.
Okay. Well, that's given Fnatic to think about.
OG's got like you're saying, like their team fight is very limited. And Fnatic's got a crazy amount of team fight coming into play.
They're gonna run at you though.
OG's gonna look to just
they're gonna run at you.
Set the pace and be the ones, the aggressors. They can't slow down though.
So the fun part is now Abe gets to say like I wanna play XYZ.
Wow. They go back for his tiny. It's a lot of melee heroes. And that's 5 melee heroes, in fact, on Fnatic. Yeah. But it's with the Surge. The AoE Surge at level 20.
Aura stack AoE Surge. Shout out to Puppy.
He did do that at CQ, and they dominated that game. We all were very questionable about it, too, and it was just a complete stomp.
Well, but and the thing is, we questioned it because we felt like the opposing lineup had a lot of tools to punish the 5 melee heroes. I'm not convinced that this OG lineup has the tools that you talk about to punish melee.
Yeah, kind of inclined to agree. And they don't really have like this Nyx. He's good versus he's good versus ET and he's good versus Darkseer, but versus the other heroes, they don't really care too much about him.
There's also some questions around which lanes they're going to use.
Yeah, I just have, I'm not too sure. I'm not too sure who's mid.
That's going to be the question. If OG has something in their back pocket in terms of these laning matchups, that's what's really going to turn this game, because unless they can surprise Fnatic with some of these lanes, I think this Fnatic lineup is...
Okay, there's the thoughts from our panel, of course. Time now to head to the arena for game number one.
An action-packed draft, good Dota, a wonderful arena, and two amazing casters. We have almost everything but one of those. Kyle, hello, welcome to the broadcast, and let's get started. Fnatic versus OG, game one. I'm hoping for some excitement.
Yeah, me too. The last series was quite a display from Secret, but you know, when you know who's going to win, it can be a bit dull at times, but they certainly deserve their place in the grand final. OG, Fnatic, TI winners versus the undisputable best team in Southeast Asia at the moment.
Yeah, Fnatic have to do it hard as well. They're the last representative of Group B. Everyone else has come through that Group A part and just survived. So OG, they were heavily tested, of course. Fnatic, it's been a little bit more of a bumpy run, going down to Gambit 2-1. They went against Bineski 2-1 as well. So every series has gone to 3 for this team. And I'm kind of surprised, Kyle, and I'm wondering too, like, does Fnatic have that momentum lost from the group stage? Because they looked really, really, really clean in the group stage.
Yeah, but I think that the meta's developed. I think a couple players have been discussing in the interviews where there's two events going on simultaneously. So there's just, it's almost like more than a TI's worth of games being played around the world. There's so much to learn and steal from these other regions. and these other teams in these events. And Fnatic, they haven't really adapted too much. They're sticking to their strengths. You've demonstrated by the last pick on the op-ed, Tiny. Nothing really unique about this, and they've lost a bit of the edge strategically, but they've been outplaying a lot of their opponents. And in this game, they're going to need to play very quickly. I'm afraid for what OG might be able to do if they get a bit of an advantage. They'll just have so much aura stacking to deal with.
You mean these, well, of course you can also look to the late game of OG, the PA and Dooms, this never-ending income that comes in from the Doombringer and the Phantom Assassin, who have seen many times just crit their way to victory. But you are right with, like, also auras coming in from Fnatic's side, but also combinations from their side. Their team fight looks a lot of fun, and putting the weight on the shoulders of Ice is something he's always stepped up to as well. On a Darkseer, this man's preparing for the long haul. Three mangoes, six tangoes. This Darkseer wants to live.
Yep. And I look forward to seeing Notel playing this support Prophet. One of the, really the only team left that will reliably first pick this hero, knowing that 9 times out of 10 it'll be Notel. They know, of course, that Seb could play it as well, like we saw yesterday. But he can do a... If he bodies this Lifestealer, the win condition from Fnatic is going to be delayed. And that puts a lot of pressure on the Darkseer of Ice. It's not, you know, you can do this cool little gimmick here, killing the creep wave behind tower. What they're going to do is try to get DJ level 2, and then look to either have him TP top with an ion shell placed on him preemptively, or perhaps look to go mid, where Thompson's Venge, have we seen him play this hero? I figured it would be this once I saw it picked, because he just refuses to play normal things.
The panel were questioning, I was actually checking the heroes that weren't played before, like this week, and Vengeful Spirit was most definitely in that list. So it's a new one for him. We were hoping for the Invoker pickup with mass buffs going across the field, but we get the VS instead. My LTW, he gets to play the offlane PA.
You can see up top, MP did a really cool trick here where he actually pulled aggro on a couple of creeps. Jarex and Notel were unable to stop him, so he's going to continue to maintain lane control. Even though, like, this is late in the game, theoretically, just based on the number of waves. So he's already level 2. He hasn't really been pressured like you'd want as a tri-lane.
Can you actually pressure him in the tri-lane when you've got Elder Titan standing right behind him? That's plus 75 damage as well. Welcome to the company. Yep. Notel's down already. Jabs, it was a quick rotation over. And Jabs got that damage out. It was DJ with the Iron Shell buff up from Darkseer that just made that work.
Told you, you get level 2 off 2 waves. Darkseer is now guaranteed going to be able to sustain himself in this lane. And because you have that Ion Shell, that's just too much. OG has no chance. And because their support combo is so weak at these early levels, like, what does Aphirion do on the defensive? His whole concept is to pressure like he is now. Hit the Elder Titan. Don't allow these enemy supports to trade. But when you get those kills, all of a sudden this lane is equalized.
Great rotations from Fnatic. This is the crisp kind of play we saw from them in the group stage. And them setting the tempo of the game against OG, very critical for him.
I like what Seb's doing too, though. You can see down bottom, he's rushed Glove of Haste, and he's got 2 points Devour. He's just going to try and accelerate as fast as possible towards that Midas and abuse the fact that, sure, Darkseer is going to be able to get every CS in back lane, but I'll get far more net worth as this game continues because I can play as greedy as I want to.
You're talking about OG having a bad early game and then a good comeback around the 15-minute mark. Kyle, I am surprised. They still look to try and fight up on top lane, but Earth Spirit, without the buff up from the Iron Shell, maybe doesn't feel as confident. Notel's chip damage is starting to do some work. That's why Jabs is already burning off the Salvage, ready to fight once more.
And you got to be careful as OG. Abed just bottled the Haste Rune bottle. So they're going. 2 minutes.
Rolling Boulder in towards the top. They're after Notel. The stun from G-Ranks will create a little bit of space, but Notel still can't survive. MP, Jabs, and DJ all focusing on the support Prophet, then turning their attention to G-Ranks. Heavy damage, but they won't find the kill.
And a big part of that, Jabs already had the kill and the assist earlier, so he has the early boots along with the shield. He can play very aggressive, and they can just continue to kill Notel. They saw him canceling the TP.
No TPing into base this time around. Summons up the tree, sees Jabs in the tree line. He's already got the spirit out looking for the extra buff, and he's got a plus 63. But still, the trees as well as Notel focusing on it. Great double stun from G-Rex onto DJ as well as Jazz, but they're going to find the damage into ILTW. And they're not done just yet. DJ's running away from the trees and Notel himself. The Jabs, Stick Charge just lets him stand a little bit longer, plus the spirit refresh. G-Rex doesn't have much more to give. Actually, he does if he wants to burn the mango. He'll have a stun available, and they move up towards MP. No rage build on the Lifestealer, but G-Rex has done well off the mark. And they actually wrapping around?
They're going to double suicide themselves.
DJ and Jabs underneath the tier 2 tower. The TPs are coming in. Oh, wait, hang on. No Tails TP back to the tower to try and chase down jabs in the tree, so he can actually get some experience from this.
Abed, he was used the haze middle, so we won't see any rotations. He's actually, Thompson doing surprisingly well in this mid lane, and I think jabs is totally fine giving that kill away to No Tail. You can see just the early kills. You have a shield on the Lifestealer, a shield on the Elder Titan. They can play so aggressive, and because all three heroes have boots, and No Tail doesn't, not really much he can do once he gets initiated on. Bottom lane, look at Seb. He's going to have his Midas completed in this wave. A 4.5 minute Midas. It'll be at him by about 5:10.
SAP boys can have fun with that one. We'll have fun with the top lane fight. ILTW, way too much damage once again. Jabs hit so hard, but the stick charges, it gives him more life. They'll come underneath the tower, he's still alive! 14 HP! The Phantom Assassin is able to strike away. And Fnatic can't ensure the kill, but they're looking to rotate over. Get the bounty runes. Jirax has his Earth Spike available, so he can look for his right target. The runes will spawn, but as Jirax is being initiated on, trying to find the kill, ILTW burns the shrine already so they can get into the fight. No Tail, no point in Sprout. So no control on Fnatic just yet.
Yeah, all four runes went the way of Fnatic. Ice. He's always pushing that bottom lane, so there's really nothing that Seb could do to contest those runes. And yeah, the first Midas usage at 5 minutes and 13 seconds. 100% efficiency. And yeah, the fastest on the patch so far.
2 seconds. Yep. 2 seconds. But 2 seconds is enough. It's like a 100-meter sprint.
Yep, this is the traditional way to counter a Darkseer. Really any hero with high base regen, especially one that can just eat these Ion Shell creeps, you force Darkseer to backlane you, and just, you're never really able to be pressured, especially as a Doom. So you just free farm, but you get to itemize for raw scaling, whereas Darkseer has to invest in regen. He's more of this mid-game tempo hero, so he's got to buy Arcane Boots at the very minimum or a Soul Ring. You just rush Midas, and Seb is going to scale astronomically as this game continues, already with that fourth point in Devour.
Wow, a dream game for Seb. Yeah. We haven't seen those. But he'll have a great time, as you said, but up on the top lane. I want to keep my eyes there. Fnatic, they move both the supports off the lane, but it's an Iron Cell surged up ES, running straight towards the front lines. It's a good stun from Jirax, actually curving it around into MP as well. They'll chase down No Tail with the stomp, slow him down, and sleep him up, kill him off. No Tail falls. Now, Jirax, not much more he can do when MP rages. The stun is now going to come off cooldown, but it's too late. It's already a double kill for MP. They're looking for the third into ILTW, the last remaining player of OG's offlane. The TP out will be successful, and he goes all the way home.
But you got to bear in mind that Fnatic need these kills. This is the way their draft is supposed to operate. It's get the Earth Spirit involved and find hero kills. There's really no other way for them to be accelerating. Mid is a trade, but bottom lane, you've got to be concerned just because Seb is going to be such a force in this game thanks to the free farm he's acquired. Got to keep playing fast for Fnatic, the toss back.
Yep, it's good in towards the mid lane. Thompson being dragged around, and there's nowhere he needs to be. He's got Wave of Terror, no stuns available, so he just gets that negative armor into Abed. The stun, it does not reach for Jirax, but Abed, another quick toss, throw in the ES. He doesn't have any other abilities, DJ. But he'll have it in 2 seconds' time, and that's why Ice just moves over. DJ will be the one to find the kill.
And an interesting build from Thompson as well. He went for raw stats, 3 Wraith Bands, then Boots. Max aura, 3 points Wave of Terror. No point in stun, no point in swap.
Is it all preparing for this huge, for a huge group up? Like, is that what this is meant for, or?
We'll have to wait and see, but it certainly increases his ability, his pushing power. But as he said himself, he's either Thompson or Flopson. We'll have to wait and see how this game develops before we can actually make a judgment on the TI winner.
MP, thinking about going after No Tail. And then he will. He'll start it off with the open wounds. Rage is still available. Here comes your rolling boulder in. Is there a silence or a kick? There will be, but it's over towards Jirax. And that's when they switch their target over. But Jirax gets another double stump, but still loses his life. It's Ice. The man who's not on this lane that gets the kill. Once again, this Iron Shell high level onto the ES, and they rotate him towards the top lane.
Yep, that was really cool from Jirax, though. He tanked the roll stun to ensure that No Tail would be able to survive. Almost got out of dodge, but just not enough. Yeah, just keep Fnatic, they've got to keep the pressure up. Ice has arcanes, he's rushing mech now. OG should be able to outscale as this game continues. The Venge will, like, Venge is so much, not a harder carry than you'd realize, but he does way more damage than people recognize, especially considering that the Doom will probably have a Wolf at some point, and it's all about giving this PA a steroid, as they've demonstrated time and time again, they know how to do, they know how to win games with it. Seb, probably on Doom, yep.
Oh, yep.
already got it off. Ice can tank through this. The problem is he can't run away from the Doombringer, who's pumping in more damage, and that he cannot tank over. Elder Titan moving in, looking for a denial, and yeah, she gets it! Jabs! Seb just needed one hit to land the kill off the Darkseer.
Yeah, I love the build from Seb here. Just Midas, Phase, Drums. His whole concept is going to be, I'm going to get to a point where I'm just going to run at this Fnatic lineup. He's the answer to the ET, the Tiny, and the Earth. Really, the entire side of Fnatic just gets wrecked when he gets enough points into that Infernal Blade. So he has to get ahead of the game and then be the aggressor, be that tempo hero.
Rolling Boulder up on top, they're going up to Notel once again. MP and Rage, they need more damage quicker, and they've got it! Thanks to the Infest pop, Notel will fall with no Jirax to save him this time.
And that actually finishes his Midas as well. A bit behind Seb's, but this is a lifestealer after all. But you can see already 2,000 net worth behind. It's kind of, I feel like I almost understated just how fast this Doom can farm when you max Devour in addition to having a Midas. Every 40 seconds, he's using it off cooldown. He devours a creep for an extra 100 bonus gold in addition to the Midas. This is... it's not balanced. He's going to be so farmed.
Hey, you've only got a difference of, what, 6 minutes on the Midas between MP and him? That's fine.
And it's always these auras, man. Oh, look at Thompson. Wow. Three Wraithbands into Vlads.
DJ and Arbet, they smoked between both of their Observe Wards and right on top of an OG Observer Ward and the Radiant scanning just to make sure they're on bottom lane. But they knew they were dead because Jirax is able to land the stun and control the Bounty Rune on bot.
You can see, look at the item that Seb's queued up. Radiance. You want to talk about not being on a clock.
It's the hard carry Doom. Looking for a target. Ice. There she tosses back, trying to get the double man into the wall, but maybe they have extra support as DJ arrives. It's a great kick in silence, hitting No-Tail as well. Seb is so low on life, and MP has arrived for the fight. He'll get the open wounds out and the kill onto Seb, but they want more. Another toss forward. Arbet claiming Jirax and the rolling boulder. No-Tail, he can't complete anything. He'll go down as well. And Fnatic, they bring the numbers, they bring the strength. And they'll take that tier 1 tower.
Yeah, perfect play. Fnatic understand that their draft will fall off. They need to continue to play with tempo, play around Ice. It's very difficult to bring Darkseer to your other lanes. You want to ensure that you're playing into his area of the map. So even though that smoke was scouted out, Abed with a surprise haste rune shows up and they just go full Divine. And there's really nothing OG can do to stop the Fnatic lineup if there are four people diving. So the toss back into the wall was quite nice. Seb might have lived here, but as you can see, he's going to escape up top. If he gets the net off onto the Lifestealer before this hit, maybe he lives, but unfortunately, we'll go down to that last right click. Jirax as well under tower. Another roll from DJ. Guys, been on point with this Earth Spirit. Look at his KDA already. 2-1-9. Part of 11 of 12 kills in 11 minutes.
The ES just absolutely everywhere, and they go for more fights. Speaking of which, DJ rolling boulders in. No-Tail tries to hide himself inside the sprout. It won't work as Seb underneath the tier 1 tower, being chased down by four heroes. Thompson is nearby, gets a good wave of terror off. They'll swap him back in. They want the kill onto Ice. He is sitting at 7 hours, and that's still enough, or maybe it's not. Not what LTW brings his own form of damage in, hiding the kill, jabs, no, the stun's available, he will not be able to get the stomp off. MP Radius will block the magic missile, he's inside DJ, he needs a rolling boulder away, no one can block the rolling boulder out, so DJ back under the tier 1 tower, the medic taking lifesteal into safety, but is he done just yet?
This is where the draft of OG starts to get scary though. Abed with another incredible rune.
Is Blink forward, able to actually hit a huge avalanche, but where's the follow-up? It's not there yet. Seb is the main man in the front lines, tanking it all through. Darkseer's only just gonna respawn, but you've already managed to get a two off. Two heroes down for OG. ILTW looking to fight once again. He's underneath jabs, a triple kill for this ET. How hard is this man hitting? Plus 204 damage on an Elder Titan 13 minutes in, and the chase is continuing. They're looking towards the Earth Spirit. Seb's trying to do the work. He's still in the middle of this entire fight. No-Tail will arrive too. Sprouting up DJ, trying to isolate the Earth Spirit. He's got no man to really work with while Lifesteal is having his own battle on the side. DJ will go down. Jirax as well. This is just scrappy fighting.
Talk about excitement. I feel like we've already had more than we did in the entire previous series. 17-6, but it's still a relatively even game because OG is going to continue to out naturally GPM the Fnatic lineup. And you can see just both teams really understanding their win conditions. This is just really fun to watch. Thompson, keep in mind that change to your Venge aura, you now automatically spawn what used to be your Ags ability of an illusion of yourself when you die. So you'll maintain that Vengeance aura along with the Vlad's aura, even if you take him down first. That's 45% plus damage to Sed and ILTW's PA.
This is a really nice kill if they can actually claim it, trying to move around, but support is arriving. Fnatic is coming in, a quick silence over on the Doombringer. He doesn't have Doom available for the moment as Jurex is the one who's sticking out thanks to the Magnetize of DJ with the back in. Jurex still ticking down so low, but the damage is being done the opposite direction. Thompson and Notar claiming kills their own. Let's make it three. Sed will take the unstoppable spree of MP, but they're not done yet. Jabs, trap, and killed. Fnatic, we swing back the other way.
Did I mention as well that Doom finally found a Wolf Creep, so now Seb's got a bonus Venge aura for plus 30% damage. He was hitting for over 220. It's 14 minutes into the game. All he has to do, like, this is the concern that I have with Fnatic's lineup. If you don't have this massive execution around your initiation, OG, they have about as much damage as old Drow lineups did. They can just stand still and click you to death, and the raw power of this team, you can see, MP recognizes, I can't afford to wait for Radiance. We have to continue to play fast. Seb is 3,000 gold ahead of his nearest opponent.
Sure. Doombringer things. Do you actually think the BKB is the way to go, as opposed to like building up auras, building up more teamfights?
I think if you go BKB, you equalize, and all of a sudden, Fnatic don't even have the ability to target Doom. Now he's going to be able to take out whoever he wants and run straight at Jabs. He was crucial to winning that engagement in the mid lane. He had a two-man stomp, but Doom just eats Elder Titan for breakfast. You can't actually get off a stomp if Doom is in the area because he just spams Infernal Blade on you.
Which is why the ET's just turned into a spirit level of damage, because at least you're going to cast that before the fight begins. So he's actually hitting just as hard as the Doombringer does, technically, with the plus 200 damage on both sides of that fence.
But problem is, ET's got 5 armor, down to negative 1 once he gets hit by that wave of terror.
Doom's got 9.
Exactly. One big change, and part of the reason we see all these strength heroes, the phase boots. Same with Lifestealer. You can buy phase boots for that free 6 armor. That's so valuable. It's 30% effective HP against physical damage, and when you already naturally have such high strength gain, you're deceptively tanky just because of this change to the boots.
It's like both teams are happy just to settle things down for the moment. We don't have any, like, 5-minute runes spawning for another 4. Roshan is definitely not in the cards for anybody. They're just hoping for a couple of pickoffs here or there.
We gotta get this has to be the fastest this tournament somebody hit 10k net worth. Like 16 minutes, 20? Come on.
That's pretty damn fast. They're coming in. Observers and sentries planted. Jurex is far enough away, and thanks to his own observer ward, he sees all of Fnatic running through the Radiant jungle towards the mid lane.
And I love,
but they don't want anything to do with this. PA still farming top lane, trying to finish up this Battle Fury.
I love what OG did. Like, they were losing these skirmishes, but remember where they were fighting? Around their own shrine. They fought away from their own objectives. It's still early game. Your respawns were so low that even though Fnatic had that big advantage, at least it felt that way, they only have one tower. And ILTW took the top one. He's had total space. Now he's going to TP in because they're... And you can see Fnatic, no, we actually can't fight anymore. We are not strong enough, and I do believe the Venge just finished a pipe, and he did. They have Battle Fury, pipe. Like, remember, Thompson now will have that defensive pipe aura even after death. That's 10% less magic damage for the entire side of OG.
That's why they're looking for the better initiation. Keep your eyes on DJ. They've got the Infest, the Spirit will clip onto Jirax, but they don't have any vision, no detection around this area. So as the Observer Wall, which also gets dewarded around Roshan, they're starting it. OG are beginning Roshan. They want to see if they can find this kill. DJ is not in position. In fact, he rolling ball is in. They're looking for to get the kill over on Jurex. He's just in range of that sentry ward. So they'll find the kill. And now they want to keep doing Roshan. Not when the Darkseer wall is planted in and gets a copy over on Thompson. Doom is out. Over on the Darkseer. They're looking for the battle, but it's underneath the tier 1 tower. Sam eyes it by the rest of his team. That BKB is still triggered off, but the Doom is wearing off the Prophet. Notel, he's looking for the kill onto Ice. He wants his Darkseer dead, but he's surrounded by the rest of the Fnatic with the 4-man stun. They may actually have enough time while OG are caught sleeping. No time to TP out of the cover of Zone Sprout, but they turn off the magnetize. The ears will ring of OG apart from Seb. Doom is back and he is just standing
his ground, but he is the last survivor. No, G-Rex is here to help him out. I can't believe this is actually a 2-2 trade-off. Zeb's the one with the double kills. There's still more to be played with DJ trying to push away this BS illusion, which is threatening the ES. He will be able to survive.
That was huge. Like, just that little bit of Thompson continuing to play, he bought DJ's Magnetize because he was afraid of going down. That means for this next attempt on Roche, look at the respawn timers, 20 seconds, OG's ready to go again. You have no wall for a bit, you have no Magnetize, no Earth Splitter. You could theoretically just go straight back into the pit, and bear in mind that the longer this game goes, the more favorable OG's position will be.
Yep.
Seb, if he, like, he needs to improve his target selection a bit because he was hitting Lifestealer. Can't really touch him now, but he two-shot jabs his Elder Titan. If he guns for him first, OG's gonna shred through these engagements, and that was a four-man stomp. Like, they are catching all of the AoE combo of Fnatic, and it's still an even engagement.
Yep. And you were right, it went so quickly. I said 2-2, but it was actually a 3-2. Roshan's begun once more from OG, but ET, he is so fantastic at stopping this, and he's already been Spike Carapace stunned out.
Yep, he's just interrupting the stomp. That's all he has to do. Wait, don't catch the spirit. As soon as you see the animation, walk into it with Carapace active. You deny ET's ability to combo break, and I expect Jerix to continue to do that. Just a great understanding of his role within this game.
But OG is still being more cautious about this. They have ways to close the distance, OG. That Blink Dagger on Tiny, a heavy AoE stun inside of a clustered area like Roshan Pit, giving a combination to the Darkseer, who can also, with the changes, the way you can reposition the walls, not as dangerous. Here's your Blink Tossback. They really want to get this kill over the Doombringer. He has Doom off cooldown in 15 seconds time, that may be too long. Another BKB charge is going to be burnt, not to mention the Darkseer wall. More copies being made, so Thompson and Jerix having to deal with the illusions of Ice, 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 while MP moves back to killing off this tier 1 tower. He wants OG to not have this tower, to not have this easy access to Roshan, but they haven't done the job yet.
Look at the gold gap though, it went from 2 to 5 over the last 2 minutes because ILTW, it's still just top.
Yep.
He's just farming and he has a Battle Fury's PA, no tails bottom. OG have no fear planting Sebathy's towers. If he's threatened, he'll pop BKB. You cannot kill him. And Fnatic continue to invest 5 heroes. OG, able to repel them easily as only 3, they just continue to outscale.
It almost feels like by starting Roshan and making him a topic that Fnatic was looking at, they've dragged Fnatic all to the mid lane, which has then opened up the sidelines. OG, like, fantastic, plan has worked. We've just created almost this graviton field in mid that Fnatic just cannot resist.
Yeah, and you got 2 heroes on OG, 3 really if you count Thompson. Just, again, I really enjoy when he goes this triple Wraith Band into Vlad's because it's so stat efficient, and it goes back to that whole idea of being, you can keep items like this in your slots for so much longer because you don't have to worry about carrying the teleport. So it's just an extra Wraith Band of stats you get for free thanks to the frog. And you're at this point, if you look at the gold he has spent for the respective value his hero gets out of the items he's purchased, it's as efficient as possible. And when everyone on OG does this, with the exception of course ILTW rushing Battle Fury, they're able to take fights that maybe they shouldn't while still not damaging their ability to build economy. 6k gold lead. It's going to continue to grow by 1,000 or 2 every couple of minutes.
And Fnatic need to find an answer, because if this keeps happening, the way you're talking about it, it's like a slow bleed against Fnatic, and they don't have a really easy way. Like, there's a Band-Aid which just run 5 together, and that's it.
See, Doom's got a Relic. He'll have Radiant soon.
Yep.
And now he picks up... I thought he was going to switch Icicle, but I like keeping the Wolf. You have to play flawlessly right now as Fnatic. You need Ice, Ice, Ice to get illusions of Venge and Doom just so you can have these items, because you're so far behind. Your only real hope to win big team fights is to actually steal the art items that they've picked up for your own side.
Does Doom not have enough money going for the 150 Devour bonus gold talent over like Evasion? If he's the man on the front lines taking this battle, there's no way you have an MKB built up on Fnatic.
You can buy the Evasion with the gold, okay? At 150 every 40 seconds, okay? In 10 minutes, you can have a butterfly for free if you want.
Butterfly Doombringer. Sure, let's go for it. Fnatic has smirked up once more, looking for their own opportunity. Fortunately for Fnatic's side, they don't have great information. They're going to deward out the Observer of OG, but this gives a little bit of extra information to OG that is gone.
And just look at Seb. Again, it's just playing this perfectly. You have a blurred PA on the downside choke point. He's ensuring that when the smoke breaks, I'm still not visible. Seb standing on the opposite high ground. They know the smoke is happening, and they put the heroes that can tank that pressure in between the
DJ. Can he get the solo kill? He went for the plus 40 damage talent, and he may just have it to get this kill onto Nortel. And yep, he's silenced up, and the Magnetize will kill Nortel off.
Nice solo kill for Nies. He had a little of extra help. However, Darkseer just buffed the crap out of him.
He knows how to necrobook. Like, yeah, he recognizes I'm just going to be farming lanes all game. I don't need to do a damn thing. Doesn't even care if he dies, really. It's just more and more space.
I think Chad's realized it too, though. Like, when this smoke gank didn't work, it meant he instantly drew lines on both of the side lanes, saying, this is pushing in. We have to be able to deal with this. We can't just stand guard around Roshan. This is Fnatic. Send your courier. It'll do the job for you.
And you know, this is kind of what's been holding Fnatic back, I feel, as a team. Like, squads like OG, this is a TI winner. This is a tier one team, at least strategically right now. Mm-hmm. Fnatic, they're still 10th picking a Tiny. I just don't know if this is something that will allow you to finally start taking games off of these teams that are just more developed than you. It just doesn't feel like they have a real answer to what OG is attempting to do here just because they can't deal enough damage.
And look at the way Nertal plays this. Two Observe Wards being planted down, one right in the tree. They're going to be able to cancel off his TP out. Question is, will Fnatic work out what happened? Yeah, they're pinging out, but they may not see the other ward. He jumped in under the cover of smoke and planted a ward inside the lane. And the sentry, yeah, it's up on the hill. It's not behind the tower, and they've got a full duration observe ward out there already.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
A lot of information for OG.
And all of the items they're buying are based on only BKB. In turn, oh, three braces on Jarex, man. They're literally just going
25 back room by GBS, actually swapping it in. Uh-oh. FP wants to kill him. Bob Thompson may be regretting this decision. The Stomp is out, and the ET splitter, not to mention the Darkseer wall. Seth will trigger the BKB, looking for the target against the Doom onto Ice, Ice, Ice. They'll move back underneath the shrine, trying to protect up the Darkseer. Is there a buyback? There is one from the ES, and Darkseer still alive. The Avalanche creates the space. Jarex will finally move over as Ice, Ice, Ice will fall. The Envy is a double kill. They have so much time in the dust reveal. They want the disaster. But really, they want the Doombringer. Harped, he can't blink forward. He can't get jabs in there. They don't have enough movement speed. MP can still get the triple kill. But Zed will be able to walk it off. There's no shrine charge for him. Abed's not finished with it. He jumps in. He'll get the avalanche and the toss. He finds the kill. What a huge streak. 1356 gold for the kill on the Doombringer. That is one rich Satan.
Yeah, OG's got to prioritize better killing off these Darkseer illusions. There was an unfriendly Doom just fighting again for that entire time. That Radiance represents 70% less physical damage in addition to, of course, the Radiance burn. And Jarex just isn't strong enough to stand these fights. The OG support's too weak to really get things done just yet.
Because if they lose Roshan, like, they're rolling bouldering in, that not a lot of damage from Fnatic, but they had so much space created because so many players of OG went down. The Fnatic are the ones to claim it. They even left a quarterstaff sitting inside the pit. Yeah, Envy, you may want to pick that up.
Remember, OG wanted that fight. That was an aggro swap from Thompson, but he placed himself in such a poor position that he just dies immediately. Really didn't get a chance to get any spells off even. Just died. And fighting in that area as OG, look at the Fnatic lineup. They need you to clump together to hit these big spell combos, and you walk up the tightest choke point that exists on the map.
I don't think we've also seen such a useful use of the new, like, angled Darkseer wall. Like, he put it over the rune and then up the ramp, so no matter how they want to play this left to right, they had no choice but to continuously walk through it. More and more illusions. The same thing happened behind the tier 1 tower in the mid. It's not just a buff up, he's not just a grease for the team. Ice is being such a presence in this, and copying the Doombringer, as you said, it's something that OG cannot allow to happen. But as you said, this is a TI winning team. They're gonna pull their heads in. Focus up while Abed may be potentially finding his own kill. But he needs friends. There's a BKB over on this PA, maybe they can burn that. Avalanche toss up. There's the BKB burner, and he'll just TP out right away. The ET splitter, that'll cancel the TP. It pierces that immunity, and now Phantom Assassin needs to have Zed nearby to get the Phantom Strike over, gets him away from the stomp. They thought maybe he went invis, by judging by the dust trigger and the tree clearance.
Really well played by Zed there, ensuring his friendly PA can get out of dodge. Finishes a blink dagger as well, so their initiation will have a much easier time now. Instead of looking for a swap, Zed can just go try and find that Doom on the Darkseer, who, if you Doom Darkseer pre-wall, that's the tools, that's what OG needs to win this engagement. That's huge. It came out in that fight, but it already had time to back wall and pop mech. It's just not enough.
I should totally take back what I said before about no MKB building with a lifestealer. It was 15 minutes ago, but correct the mistake. He already has the MKB up and running. Fantastic against PA, and my god, it was needed, and against the Radiance.
And he, like, all of a sudden, you know, the new PA, or well, the new Lifestealer, doesn't have that same really poor relationship against PA that he did in the previous patches. Just because Midas is now a staple part of your build, so you're going to continue to outscale, even though, or scale evenly, even though you don't have the Battle Fury. He's hitting real hard. You got a question now. Seb, yeah, sure, he's so far ahead of the game, but it's getting to the point where you're like, whoa, that's a Doom, though.
Yep.
Is this as valuable as we thought it was? He's going to finish a Shiva's eventually.
As long as he's walking around with the aura, right? Like, it's still the buff up of the heavy damage. It's almost feel like Thompson needs to be able to stand and be something more in these fights, not that swap into, well, oh my god, we need to save Thompson moment.
Yep.
And the BKB will help him on that front, but it's still taking time. Like, he's got so much, like, he's got 280 damage standing where he is right now next to the Doombringer. That's fantastic if he can be immune.
And that's where the Darkseer comes in, the fanatic lineup. You have ET.
Going again. Magic Missile is out. Darkseer, well, he's just going to create a wall. A new Vengeful Spirit, swap him back in again. Actually pulls him away from the kick of the rock. And they don't really want to fight this, or nice. Do they? Okay, swaps away.
He swapped the Nyx in with Carapace active, so once again, that blocks the stomp. If they can continue to do that, that's huge.
They're now going to bring the Venturer, though. Like, you got a copy of this illusion for 23 seconds with the creep wave coming in. Fnatic now want to actually push the tier 2 tower, but maybe they won't have enough time because we've got up on top lane the TV the Shrine with the Infest combo. Arbed trying to get the kill on Seb, another BKB charge being burned. He's out of 6 seconds on this, and the ET's winner and stomp. Jirax actually going to hit so hard, but ILTW now he's got an open space. The Doom is on the high side. ILTW wants to find this kick pickoff. He's able to do so with the help of Notel around the corner. Arbed trapped inside the sprout. The goes into the means by ILTW. We can't finish the fight, but DJ doing work against Dorotel. The Ninja's Prophet will fall on Arbed. The BKB is worn off for the PA, so we can move forward with MP, beating him down in that top lane. The never-ending avalanche done is pebble on pebble into a landslide. Toxic at least trying to outmaneuver this. Run further down, but they got the rolling boulder, the movement from Fnatic. They don't need big abilities when they got such maneuverability. Goodbye, MP gets a double kill and is now godlike.
First lead Fnatic's had in this game since about the 4-minute mark. Just another poor engagement from OG, and the Necro book makes sense the way Notail was playing the game, but if he's going to look to get involved in these engagements, imagine what a Force Staff could do for his side. He ports in, like, he's dead. If Lifestealer, if Earth Spirit, if Tiny, if anyone wants to just kill Notail, they can feel free to do so because he has no real defensive capabilities, and MP is just going off. 15-1-12, talking about DJ's game. He's just hitting tower now too. And Seb, like, he reinitiated, but he was already at like 1/3 HP.
He's taking the tier 3. He's actually copped the tier 3 tower. There was no defense from OG. Jirax went on a rune hunt. But this opens up the Shrine. Seb, he really wants to try and find this kill. Rage off cooldown in 2 seconds time. He's out of mana, however, so this should be a kill. In fact, it will be Notel claiming it. There may be a rebuttal from Arbed attempted, but he's underneath the sentry ward. He thinks he's in Fizz, but he's actually not. Jirax, he doesn't hit the stump, but Seb, he'll be able to follow with the slow. Arbed slaps down. Do they have the damage to get the kill? Then they will. No TP out from this one. Arbed wants a revenge on Notel. The avalanche will allow that to happen. But man, that trade-off, he's dead for a long time. 80 seconds on the sideline.
God, they just equalized. You're going to have to buy back here if you want to defend your racks. You can see this is the danger of OG's lineup. Yeah, sure, Fnatic, you can continue to win these team fights, especially if OG misinitiates.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as raw damage output goes, if the three cores of OG are nearby and able to hit that same target, he will explode. And look at this.
That's a nice OBS. It's on the end of Blink. It's actually going to be a jump forward in from Thompson, canceling DJ, the rolling boulder out. But now we've got Darkseer Illusions. And, well, you're not going to hold the high ground. He's just summoned his own army into a stomp. A good blink away from ILTW. Gets him out of range of that stomp of ET. But OG disengaged. They cannot push high ground during this 80-second death time that Tiny granted them.
But this is huge because you have a Doom. You don't even necessarily need to Doom the Lifestealer. Let's say you just get a favorable engagement off the backs of the Darkseer death. If you can kill MP now, you'll have nearly 2 minutes of a 4-on-5. And Lifestealer is really the sole source of raw, sustained damage output in these engagements, along with the Darkseer Illusions. And shout out to Notail. Not just Fada can break records.
I love how this crowd is applauding the death of Notail. Thank you very much, Katowice.
What a happy, happy crap.
That's the advanced analytics that we've come to count on.
He's been everywhere, man. He's been everywhere. OG, now it's their turn to get aggressive, but
they are ready. They're looking to jump in. Look for the stun. Arbed isolated inside the front. IOTW is taking so much damage. The ET splitter. OG pretty well defended and already the lifestealer. He was doomed up by the DEVIL, and he'll go down so quickly. Arbed trapped in again. IOTW has a triple kill. Fnatic have three players. Players pushing up the daisies, and three of them will remain manure. They cannot buy back into this game.
You know what was all about that fight, Toby? No wall. The wall was still on cooldown. I'm questioning, holy crap, like, why is OG walking up another high ground? But they have an understanding that they just won't lose this fight.
Here it is again.
Like, the VAC comes out, but there's no follow-up. And you can see, Fnatic, they have no idea what to do here. The Doom comes out on Lifestealer. He can't rage. Look at him. Watch him die.
Yep.
There's that damage output, there's that aura combination. Fnatic with no answer whatsoever. And because they're dead in the world of the live, they still are in the same position. Are they pinging out to go for tier 4 towers? I think they're trying to force out buybacks from Fnatic by at least threatening the position of the tier 4 towers. They will claim the top melee rack, so guaranteed racking. Instant pressure shifted to the mid.
Yeah, and you know why it looked like Lifestealer exploded? Because that attack from ILTW was on the Elder Titan that attacked the bench W. He was at zero armor. The cleave damage ignores armor value, but not armor type. Effectively, it means he did pure physical damage on that crit. And all of a sudden, your half HP Lifestealer is in the grave with no buyback. Roche respawning in 6 seconds. A favorable spawn for OG. They're collecting all the bounty runes. And what wasn't even game is suddenly about to be a 20,000 net worth advantage.
Yeah, right off, we look at how much gold swung for the bounty runes. Bring up the graphs. There is the vertical climb. It is an Everest for OG. Experience does the same type of thing. Fnatic, they actually had the lead in experience, but it swings up by almost 20,000.
Admittedly, I counted Fnatic out way too early, but the danger of this OG lineup is if you lose one fight, you have lost the game, especially at this stage.
It's an unlucky number 13 on the board for No-Tail.
That's the push. Fnatic, they come out once again, but they'll come out underneath Observer Wards. They're here to try and get rid of any vision that OG have, because it's the last lane. This is what they need to control. The vision game on the southern border, and they may even find a target, but it's OG finding it. Is there a rebuttal? The stun's around. Ice. This wall needs to come down. Has he actually got it? He's juking around. Ice survived. PA, the AOC wall will crack. They want to re-engage. Here comes your Dark Seal wall up and running. They get a couple of copies. The stuns, they just keep chaining out. Arbed now going to be broken free. Tops up the BKB. That crit from ILTW, jabs is complete, but the three-man stun! GRX, the master of the earth, and he'll actually get even more! Fnatic, they're all down for the count, and GG well played! OG, the swingers of Dota!
At the end of the day, Fnatic to play better than OG the entire game if they want to close this out. That's the OG style. They probably don't even believe how easy that was.